Oh, okay, welcome. A stressy morning for me. As you know, I'm commuting from Kalmar, and today I had a meeting that did so I had to travel by car. And man, was it hard to find parking lots here in Växjö. It was really, really tough. So, but I'm here, and as I said, after the lectures, we can have some time for questions as well. I can, because I'm traveling by car today, I can stay if you like. But what are we going to do today? We are going to, whoa, like that. Today we are going to talk about JavaScript. And if you have a course in JavaScript or speak about JavaScript, you need GIFs because that's like mandatory. So that's why I have a GIF on the first slide. So you will don't have any GIFs on the rest of them. But this is how I hope you will feel coming from Java going into JavaScript. You see those guys in the back? They are programming in Java. And this is what you are going to do, more or less. No, but what you will find with JavaScript opposed to Java is that JavaScript is really, really free as a language. You could do stuff in so many different ways. You are not restricted by a compiler that tells you to do that or this or that. You are free to do more or less what you like. However, that's not always a good thing because you will find maybe the lack of clear boundaries as a hard thing. It will be hard to know exactly what to do in certain circumstances. So I've been like thinking forwards and backwards, how should I present JavaScript to you because you have some kind of developer background. How many of your hands up has programmed in Java? Okay, C sharp. Okay, C++, C. Yeah, now I think everybody has raised their hands. That's good. So I mean, the prerequisites for the course is that you have an have programmed in an object-oriented language, a classic object-oriented language, and I will lecture with that knowledge. So I won't go through what inheritance is. I won't go through what classes is. I expect you to know that. But I will like show examples of how you could, if you like, I'm not saying it's a good idea, but I say if you like, you could mimic those concepts that you are familiar with, like inheritance and classes, and mimic them in JavaScript. But because of JavaScript is a totally different language, you can do it in other ways as well. So the lectures I've prepared is like, okay, I will present JavaScript. We will go through the differences between mainly Java, C sharp, because they are so alike, and JavaScript. And I will show how to do like classes and stuff. However, last night, spending a lot of time thinking about this, maybe if I had the ability to redo those lectures all over, maybe I should have taken another approach, just showing you functional programming and not talking about object-oriented solutions and patterns at all. But that was like last night. And I still think it's a good idea to show JavaScript in the form that you are familiar with. So after those two lectures of today, I hope you will have some kind of grasp of the language JavaScript, and you can do exploration on yourself if you want to like dive into functional programming, for instance. Functional programming is some kind of it's another mindset from object-oriented programming. Instead of focusing on the real world or real-world objects and their hierarchies, you focus more on what to do instead of what you're doing it with. But yeah, we will get into that at the end of the lecture. I have Slack on a really, really low-res monitor In front of me. So if you that are students have questions during the lecture, you're free to ask them in Slack. John will monitor, as usual, the live coding TV site and copying or pasting questions from that site as well. Oh, this setup isn't optimal. I don't know where the screens are. Is that screen? No. Okay, could do it like that then. So, I won't have a big history lesson about JavaScript. I will have a short one though, quite short. Remember last week I talked about Tim Berners-Lee inventing the web in the beginning of the 1990s. You remember Netscape and internet or Microsoft battling out adding cool features to the browser, which Tim Berners-Lee wasn't that fond of because that was not the plan for the browser or HTML to just add some blinking stuff to it. So when Netscape later on started to investigate how to make a programming language for the browser, Java tried to get into the browser, and we had Java in the browser because in the middle early 90s, Java was the language that was supposed to rule everything. We should have Java exactly everywhere. However, in the browser, Java never succeeded. It was just too hard to do stuff. It didn't work probably. So what happened was that Netscape started or gave a man called Brendan Eich and gave him he was constructing languages, and they gave him the mission to add a language to the browser. And Brendan Eich was really fond of a programming language called Scheme. So he started creating a language with APIs upon Scheme that were supposed to be in the browser. However, when the engineers at Netscape saw this programming language, Scheme wasn't very well used. It was a functional language that was like somewhere in the outer parts of the programming community. So when the engineers saw this creation, they were like, "No way, we don't understand anything. Couldn't you make it look like Java? Because we know Java, we know the syntax, we know how to program. So can't you make it? You can have those stuff you have in the language, but can't you like add a layer of that it looks like Java?" And he did. So he added the syntax that is really similar to Java. So when you will look at the syntax today, you will recognize a lot of stuff because they are borrowed from Java, which borrowed them from C++ and Fortran and so on. However, it wasn't called JavaScript from the beginning. That's a long story. I won't tell it. I have a reference that you will have to check out. I should show it in a minute. But for a long story short, when Netscape and Microsoft started to notice that, oh, maybe we shouldn't, because Netscape developed JavaScript or LiveScript, as it was called back then, and Microsoft just copied the whole thing, everything. They did a really good job in copying LiveScript or JavaScript. They copied every bug, everything. So it was more or less Microsoft ran their own version, but they called it JScript instead because they couldn't call it JavaScript because Java was owned by Sun Microsystems, and only Netscape were allowed to call something with Java in the name. But after a while, Netscape and Microsoft, they started to work together, and like with everything, V3C, the standard organization, had been started, and Microsoft and Netscape were in that one, and they started to work together. And then they came with this idea that we should have a programming language in the browser, telling Sir Tim Berners-Lee that, "Okay, could we add this to the language?" And he was like, "You have destroyed so much in the browser already, so no, please, no." So they couldn't add JavaScript to the V3C, where all other standards are like CSS and HTML. So instead, they found a standard committee in Europe called, I think it's called ECMA actually, and said, could you standardize this for us and help us with the standardization work? And they said, yeah. So what should we call it? Well, let's call it ECMAScript. We don't have a good name yet, so we will call it ECMAScript. And so if you like start to read around, you will find different names from the past. You will find LiveScript because it was called LiveScript from the beginning. You will find it called ECMAScript today because ECMA is still standardizing this. You will find implementations in older IE browsers called JScript, and that's their interpretation of this. But today, everybody is more or less saying in the daily life, we say JavaScript. We are programming JavaScript, as you are familiar with programming Java. But the standard is called ECMAScript. So JavaScript has a standard that is called ECMAScript. And they have worked on this ECMAScript. You will notice that there are no 4. There was ECMAScript 4, which was used in ActionScript, Flash ActionScript, I think, but was later voted down, and they started to implement ECMAScript 5 instead. Working back here in the early 2000s, it was really hard to work with JavaScript because you had a lot of browser incompatibilities. Today, I would say that modern browsers are working in a really, really good way with JavaScript. They don't agree about everything. I mean, sometimes Apple and Microsoft are not agreeing on stuff. So it could take some time for some functions to be implemented in browsers, for instance. But most of the time, they are doing a really good job. And today, last month, I think, the new ECMAScript 7 was released. In this ECMAScript 7, there are no news that we will talk about today, but in the ECMAScript 2015, or called ES6, they have a lot of news to the programming language. Good news for you, because they've added keywords like class and stuff that you are familiar with since before. So today I will present ECMAScript 2015, ECMAScript 6 for you. So JavaScript, from the beginning, it was the language for the browser. But moving on, other initiatives came up. So today, we have JavaScript in other places as well. We have JavaScript on the server side, the equivalent to PHP or .NET, MVC, or Java server pages, or wherever. We have JavaScript on the server, we have JavaScript in the client, and we have JavaScript wherever we like. We could install JavaScript on a Raspberry Pi and make it do stuff for us. So JavaScript is everywhere. Some say that JavaScript is the most widespread language in the world, because every unit, modern unit today, has built-in support for JavaScript. If it's so an Android phone, iOS, or Apple phone, or computer, whatever, there are built-in interpreters into those. However, because it's an open standard, it's up to the manufacturer to implement the standard. So we have this. That can be differences, and as a developer, you need to know, okay, so if I use this new function, will it work in all browsers? You can use Can I Use, as I showed you last time, and have a look and see, okay, which browsers support this? Okay, I will reach 98% of all people living in Sweden. Okay, that's fine. We are okay with that. Or maybe it says, okay, it's not implemented in Safari. Oh, then it might be hard to use. So JavaScript is everywhere today. JavaScript is a language, just like Java. When we speak about JavaScript, most often we speak of it in the context of code running in the browser. But today, JavaScript is everywhere. So what I will show syntax, and I will try some stuff out. Let's see if I can find my way to the right monitor. I have too many of them. There. I might have to do this. So, what I've done on my computer is I have installed Node because I use Node a lot. So I have installed it on my computer. You on the assignments will probably, you can install it on your computer, or you will have it in a Vagrant machine, and instructions will come up about how to install Vagrant. But as it's an important tool for me, I have it installed. And there has been some discussions in Slack of how installing it if you have older versions. I'm using something called Node, which is a node versioning manager. So I can pick different versions and say that, okay, I want to use Node 4.2.1. And Node is a JavaScript interpreter using the Google V8 engine in the as the executing environment. So if we... Yeah. Yeah, so I need to repeat the question, but some developers said that the reason for JavaScript being big is that the V8 implementation, yeah, probably, because with the V8 implementation that Google did for the Chrome browser, everything started to grow, and Node came from that movement. Then there was some hiccups on the way, and arguments stuff divided, so we had two platforms for a while, but since like last year, they have merged together again, and today there is a really, I mean, if you saw in N, I had like Node version 0.12.0 installed, and we are now at version 6.5. I think this 0.12 was like a year ago, something like that. So it's happened, a lot have happened really, really quick, or 2 years ago maybe. Maybe it was 4.2 last year. And so, yeah, because of Google's work taking JavaScript seriously, because in the beginning of the 2000s, JavaScript wasn't taken seriously. JavaScript was used for like scrolling text on a web page, and that was that. Today you can do like, I mean, you can build whatever applications you like using JavaScript. If you take all the web applications you find out there, they are built using JavaScript. Many of the applications you find in the App Store or in the Google Play Store, they are written using JavaScript and web technologies. So yeah, everything started with a V8, I guess. And they are like leading this, I would say, today. I got a question in with what version of Node we are going to use. I recommend you to use the latest one. So I think it's 6.5.0. if they haven't changed the last number last week. Because if you go back to 4.2, for instance, you won't have native support for ECMAScript 6. So you need to add some flags and stuff to make certain things work. So I recommend the latest one. There are a long time support one and an edge one. This is the edge one, the one slightly more experimental, but for this course we will go that route. And if you have installed Node, all you need to do to start writing code is to write Node in the terminal, and you get a prompt and you can start writing code. 1 + 3 = 4, for instance, or whatever you like. So you can add statements right here. Of course, this is not a good way of programming, as you all know. We need files to structure our code and run the file. And I will show that as well, because I will show a lot of examples. The code editor I will use today is Atom. And that's because I haven't installed WebStorm. You are free to use WebStorm or Atom or whatever code editor you like for this part of the course. It doesn't really matter. If you really like the debugger for, if you like to have a, if you like Eclipse or if you like Visual Studio, you will probably like WebStorm because it's a full-fledged IDE with debuggers and all that you need. If you're lightweight, just like to write stuff in a simple text editor, then maybe you will like Atom or Sublime or something else. But I'm using Atom for this course. Actually, I will do it like this. Let's see. Projects. Lectures. Test crews. So, what I will do is just add a JavaScript file. I would call it app.js just to have something to test test this application in. Okay, so here is the app.js. I have a student func.js. I will get back to that later. And I could start writing code here as well. So 1 + 4. If I run that, I have a built-in terminal. If I run app.js, it won't say anything because this statement will be executed and nothing will happen, basically. If we want to see what that statement is, we could use the console.log, which just prints out whatever to the console. And yeah, it will print 4, 5, of course. So this is, I mean, if you want to start with a language, this is what you do. There are no need for fancy main methods and inheritance and stuff just to get started. You could just start writing code up front. And this, I think, is a really, really good idea. It's lightweight, it's easy to start using it. If you like to script stuff on your computer, it's really, really easy to get started. Yeah, so I'll get back to the examples later. Starting out, I will go... Oh, it's really hard to see. I will turn down the lights. Jon, you will have to probably fix the camera after that. It's really small, but I hope you can see. Data types. The first thing you will notice is that JavaScript is loosely typed. When you've worked in Java, you have worked with a typed language or a strictly typed language. JavaScript is loosely typed. And that means, it doesn't mean we don't have types. We have types. It's not typeless. But the types are not, we don't need to specify types at all times because the interpreter will do that for us in runtime. We don't need to care about it. So the types we have are 5. We have the undefined type, which is whatever that is undefined, but we haven't assigned something yet. So we have the undefined value, we have null, we have booleans, we have numbers, and we have strings. Those are the primitive data types. And then we have reference data types as well that are objects. And that's pretty much it. If we look at the language, we have this type of operator. We have the type of. If we write type of 42, we will get the result in a string called number. So 42 is a number. 3.14 is a number. So floats and integers are living happily together in the same data type. We have strings that are just basic strings that you are used to. You can use the quotation marks or the apostrophes. No, what are they called? Single quotes. We have Booleans, of course, true and false. We have functions, but functions per se is actually not a type, even if the type of selector will tell you that it's a function, it's actually an object. We have something now called arrow functions. I would go into those later. We have objects and we have arrays. Arrays are also objects, but they have their own literal how to make an array. I will go through them one by one. However, I forgot to say one thing on the last slide. When Brendan Nyche created the language, he got as many days to do that as you have on the first assignment. So he created this language in 10 days, or 8, or 14, something in that area. He created the whole language from scratch to a language shipped in the browsers in like 2 weeks. Stuff got wrong. Some things are wrong. So you will find stuff in the JavaScript language, if you go to the deeper parts, you will find stuff that is wrong. That, oh, it shouldn't be like this. No, it shouldn't, but if they had added a couple of weeks of bug testing at the end of that period, maybe they have found this, but they didn't. We also have some stuff that are put there of good intention, that Brandon thought that, okay, if we do this, developers will have an easy time adapting to this language, and those stuff, looking in the rear mirror, wasn't probably the best idea ever. Like, you see, I don't have semicolons on those statements, right? You are used to having semicolons in most other programming languages. In JavaScript, you don't need to add semicolons. You have something called automatic semicolon insertion. So if you forget a semicolon, the interpreter will add it for you. That was a good intention, that maybe new developers don't need to add semicolons, but sometimes things can go wrong if you're not adding semicolons. But more about that later. Okay. The data type number, just some data for you if you like. They are stored as 64-bit numbers, and they can be expressed in different ways, like an integer, a float, or exponential number. You have the usual arithmetic operations as you are used to, like plus, minus, multiplication, division. You have the, what do you call this in Java? Modulus. Yeah, it's called the remainder operator in JavaScript. It's actually not called modulus because it handles, I think it handles negative numbers in a slightly different way than the modulus operator in other languages. But if you're using the remainder operator for like checking if something is even or not, then it works just like you're used to. We have parentheses for grouping arithmetic operators and stuff. You know this. We have a special number. We have the infinity, the minus infinity. I rarely use them at all. But we have the not a number, N-A-N. And the not a number is if you try to, because we don't have types, if you try to like multiply a number with a string, the interpreter will try to do that. And multiplying a string with a number, what should happen? Oh, it won't be a number, that's for sure. And the result will be not a number. So sometimes when doing bad operations, you will find not a number as the result. The problem with not a number is that it's poisonous. So if you get another number somewhere in an arithmetic operation, everything will be not a number in the end. So you need to like trace back and find where things got wrong. I will just go over those really, really quickly because you know this. Strings. Yeah. The thing about strings, you can't use the quotation marks and the single quotation marks. In this course, we will use single quotation marks only for strings. And ask why.
Why?
Why? Because we say so. I mean, we are going to work according to a code standard. Because JavaScript is so loose, we can add a code standard file telling us how to do stuff. And we will do that. We will base our coding guidelines upon, I think, Google's guidelines. Or maybe last year we had Airbnb's guidelines. But I think Airbnb are having quotation marks and Google are having single quotation marks. So I think we have switched, or we have switched to Google's coding style. And that's why. If you like, there is nothing bad with using quotes, quotation marks instead. But in this course, we don't, because we have a coding style that, so everybody will write code in the same way. But for the language, it doesn't matter. It's the same thing as in Java. You can could mix them as long as you don't mix them in one string. Yeah, and you know the new line character as well, if you want the new line. The Booleans, nothing fancy going on here. True and false. And we had a logical operators, like and an or. And the not operator, the bang. We have, automatic type conversion, as I mentioned before. So the first one, we can all agree that 42 up here is a number. If you have a hard time seeing, the presentations are out on the course webpage. You can have it in front of you if you like. If we add a string to a number, the result will be a string. So that's simple concatenation. And that goes the other way around as well. So if there are a string and you're trying to add numbers to it, the result will be a string. Of course, you have like functions that you can use to force a string to become a number, if you like. We have the number.parseInt, for instance, that takes a string and parses it this as an integer. As I said, you can omit semicolons. I have always said that you should not, and that's because the students I've taught JavaScript has often afterwards gone to another language like Java, and to get the semicolon into your spines are a good thing when you come to another language. You could watch this video with a guy called MPJ. He's a Swedish developer working at Spotify who has a really, really great YouTube channel that I recommend, highly recommend. And he has a rant about why he does not use semicolons when he code. But at Spotify, they do. And as he said it, I agree. If you have a code standard that says you should. If you don't, you can do however you like. You probably won't run into problems omitting the semicolon. The code will work just as fine. If you omit it, it will be added at runtime. There are edge cases. He shows them off in that video. But those edge cases, you shouldn't write code like those edge cases anyway, so it won't be a problem. Okay, now it's getting a little bit more interesting. Variables. You have variables in Java as well. When you declare a variable in Java, you need to tell what type this variable should hold, right? Okay, so this should be an int, or this should be a string, or this should be an object of the class student. Because JavaScript is loosely typed, you don't need to add the type. You just say that you have a variable, and the variable can store all the types that are in the languages. There are three ways of declaring a variable. You could use three keywords. Up to ES6, var was the only one. So if you look at legacy code, JavaScript code, you will find a lot of var everywhere, because var was the only way to do it just a couple of years ago. But today, with ES6, we have other options. We have the let, the var, and the const. And I would say that var, you should probably never use var if you don't have a specific reason to do so. And that's because of the different scopes that those keywords indicate. So the normal variables you are used to in Java, they have something called block scope. Are you familiar with that? If you declare a variable inside of an if statement, inside the if block, could you reach the variable outside if?
No.
No, because you have block scope. So the variable is only available inside the block. Var, however, has functional scope. So if you declare a variable with var somewhere inside a function, think method, the variable will be available everywhere. So if you declare a var inside a for loop, the variable will be available after the for loop, for instance. This is quite different from all other or many other popular languages which have block scope. So they introduced let. Let has the same rules as you're used to. So if you declare a variable with let, it will only live inside a block. And I would encourage you to use let instead of var. If you're not have a specific reason. But then your code will be easier to read as well, because if you have constantly used let everywhere and somewhere you have used var, if I read your code, I would know that something is going on now. You are using var because you need this variable for some reason in the whole function. So please use let. I will use let, or more often I will use const. If you're using const, you are declaring a variable that cannot be reassigned. So, for instance, if I would have... let's see. If I would do something like this, let I equals 10, console log I, I equals 20, console log I. Okay, I think you all know what will happen, right? Okay, so we are declaring 10, we are logging 10, we are reassigning it to 20, and we are logging 20. But if I instead do this, we will get an exception because we are not allowed to reassign a const. However, number is a primitive type. If you're working with reference types instead, you can always change the content of the reference. You can't change the reference, but you can change the content of the reference. So if I were to point to an object, okay, I will jump in advanced here. No, we could have it to point at an array. You know arrays, right? So I is an array. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. I can actually, I hope, I can change the value inside of the array, but I can't assign it to a new array. I can't do like this. Because then we get an exception. So that's the difference between const and let in that case. Yep.
So in Java, like an array is a primitive data type.
Yeah.
But since there's only data type, number, string, and whatever in JavaScript, are they all abstract data types? Like an array in JavaScript?
Are they abstract data classes? We don't have abstract classes at all. It's an object.
Yeah.
It's just an object. It's a reference type. That's all you need to know.
Okay.
I will come into what prototypes and stuff are that builds the language after the launch, and then, yeah, you will see. Okay, a couple of minutes more. Oh, I have so much to cover. I can't be this slow. Look at that. Okay, you know in Java you have reserved words, right? You have reserved words in JavaScript as well. You can't call a variable named return. So that's the same thing here. Those are the reserved words. You know that. Okay, what's control flow? Yeah, control flow is like statements, like if statements, switch, for loops, and sequences. So sequences, you probably know, okay, the code is run from the top to the bottom in a sequence. Nothing strange there. We have the conditional statements. We have the if statement, the switch statement, and the conditional operator. You are probably familiar with those. We have the iterators, like the while statement, the do while statement, and the for statement. As I said, Brandon borrowed the syntax from Java, so those would be familiar to you. And we have recursion as well. You can self-invoking functions. Yeah?
They will be exactly the same like Java?
I will show them.
Okay.
Yeah. So, conditional statements, if statements. We have if let number equals 42. This is so hard to read, right? Damn it. I chose a new theme for this lecture. It wasn't a good thing. So, now you see it better. We have a number assigned to 42. We have the if statement. If the number equals 0, which it doesn't, we will log in the number is 0. So when I ran it, it didn't happen. I changed it to 0, run it again, and the number is 0. Anything strange going on here? Yeah. We have three equal signs, right? You are used to two. This comes back to this. So let's say this is a string 0. Should this evaluate it through? No, it would be quite strange, right? This is a string, okay, the value is 0, but I mean, we are trying with a number 0. So they should not match. Let's try it. They don't. However, if I remove one equal sign, you could probably guess what will happen, right? The number is 0. That's because of automatic type conversion. So the interpreter will try to make this true by converting the string to a number. It will also do stuff like this. So false equals 0. False equals 0 equals null equals undefined. Everything that does not, that isn't something, will evaluate it through.
What's the reason behind that?
That's because of reason. but I think that comes back to decisions made to make the language easier. If you want to test if. Let's say you have an object and you want to know if the object have a name. You could like do it like this. Object my student, that's the object. You could do it like that. Okay. If this is true, this is something. If it's false, it's undefined. Okay. Then don't. So you could do stuff like this. You don't explicitly have to like check if the name is an integer or something like that. You could just check if it's true or false. I'm not saying it's right. I'm just saying that's the design of the language.
But my question was, if you have a double equal sign and whatever it comes in result is true, right?
Because this will be true. Because it will convert this to zero. So that one will be true. However, if I change this one to one, it will be false because one isn't equal to zero. But it converts the string into a number. So it does a lot of conversion. So if you don't want to think about it, use three. So a rule of thumb, you always use three equal signs when you're coding JavaScript because then you will catch bugs and stuff stemming from this. I'll just show it in a bigger so you see it. But oh. if else, nothing strange there going on. It's the same thing as you're used to. You can omit the curly brackets if you like. Are you supposed to? You can do it like that. You can do it like that in Java as well, right? Yeah. Are you doing it like this? Why not?
It's just read. If you do that, the statement will belong only one line.
Yeah. You could easily be fooled by something like this. This is like that. Actually, so yeah, always use the curly brackets, but it's the same rules as in Java. I missed a question. Could you debug within the terminal? Yeah, you can. I think I've almost never done it, but yeah, you can debug in the terminal. Yeah, check out the documentation of Node. Switch statements. The color coding is wrong on this one, Yeah, the switch statements, they work as you expect. You have this fall through, so if you don't write break number, the switch will, if it's 3, it will fall back to 4, 5, 6, and it will log to small, and the switch statement will end. I rarely use switch, but if you do, go ahead. The conditional operator, are you familiar with that one? Have you used it? It's this one. That is. Oh, I forgot a semicolon. So if this evaluates to true, then this will be the result of the operator else this. You know it, right? Oh, so if the number reminder operator 2 is 0, it is even because we get 0. So then this operator will throw out even, else odd, and add it with a string concatenation to the output. So this number is add even or odd and log the result. If I save, at least. But I don't think that's so strange. Last thing, we will go through all the control statements. While loops, exactly the same as you're used to. Do while, exactly the same as you're used to. Nothing strange going on. I won't go into detail about those. For statements are as you are used to. We probably won't use them as much as you are used to. You're using for quite a lot, right? I did as well. I kind of like it because I know what's going on, what is done in which order and stuff. But turns out this is really hard for new programmers to wrap their minds around. But I like it, but we have better, in a functional language, we have better, easier ways of iterating stuff. And I will show that after the break. Something to note, if I would have written var instead, this I would be available outside of the for loop. We don't want that, so we just write let instead. You have the plus-plus operator. Are you using that a lot? Like that. And you know the difference between those, right? Incrementing after and before and stuff. I think because you will see some presentations by Douglas Crockford. And Douglas Crockford he's like the superstar of JavaScript, or the father. Even if he didn't create the language, he's like the father anyway, because he's quite outspoken, and Brendan Eich isn't. He have written some books in how to use JavaScript in a good way, where he has banned, more or less, using plus-plus, because it's... And that's not only in JavaScript, he hates plus-plus, he hates it in every language, because we have another operator that does the same thing, that is this one. So you can always check out the Douglas Crockford rant on plus-plus operator if you like. You don't need to agree with him. I don't even do that. But it has been kind of a standard in the community to never use plus-plus because of that. You're free to do it. I won't kill you. Maybe code standard will. So if the Google developers thought plus-plus was a bad idea, the code standard may actually forbid it. But you will be... You will note, you will have like a red line if so. I will show the code standards later on in the course. Nothing else fancy going on here. It's just like you're used to. Break and continue. They are in the language as well. Are you using continue a lot? No, me neither. It's the same thing with continue. It's like a bad practice to use it, but it's in the language and you can if you like. We have the break as well if you need to break the active iteration or break the iteration altogether, I should say, or cancel. You have comments, you have the one-liners, and you have the multi-liners, and you have the documentation with a double what's it called? Multiplier sign. Asterisk, yeah. So this is more or less reserved for documentation, and you have what's it called? Java doc in Java, and you have JS doc in that works in the same way as in Java. So if you want to document your code, you could use JS doc. Nothing else to say about comments. Yeah, we might prohibit, or we do prohibit using single line comments after a statement. So the code standard says that you are not allowed to do this. And that's because of reason. So if you want to comment something, you need to do, I think you need a blank line before the comment as well. But that is all in the code standard, not in the JavaScript language. Yep. No. Okay, we have a lot to cover, and we need a break, and we need like 7 minutes. Oh, I that was hard for John to do. 10 minutes. So 10 minutes break. So, okay, that's comments. I will hurry on. Whoa, functions. This is where it starts to get interesting. When you have coded Java, if you are going to do a function, you will probably call it a method, and you will place the method in a class, and then you will make an object out of that class, and then you have your method or function available to you. In JavaScript, you can just do functions really easy by just using the keyword function. So if we like, we could do like a function greet that takes a text as a parameter and just console log or name, actually. Let's take a name and we can log this by using name greets you, like that. And then we can call the greet function like that. So if you never have seen JavaScript, still I think you will kind of know what's going on here. It's quite intuitive to every programmer that, okay, we have a function that has a parameter that does something, it logs the name, and then it greets you. So let's just check that it works. Undefined greet you, yeah, of course. We need to add something. Johan greets you. And here you see this is something that is strange as well. It was a good thing I forgot that, because if you had done this in Java, you would have an exception saying that you didn't send in the the arguments to the function. But in JavaScript, it's okay. You can call it with 0 arguments or 10 arguments. It will try to match the first argument against this. If there are none, name will be undefined. Yep.
As you said, if 0 to 10, what if you have a two functions with the same name and different parameters?
We don't have overloading in JavaScript. So in Java, you have overloading. You can have two functions or two methods with the same name, but with different parameter sets. And they will have they will be identified according to what parameters are added. We don't have overloading in JavaScript. It wouldn't be possible because of the loosely typed language. You can only have one identifier called the same. Yes. I can have two greets, but let's see if this might be. Yeah, let's see what happens. If I do something like this, I have two now. It still works. What happens is that this one is being declared, and this one is writing over the first one. So this one is actually just garbage collected. I forgot one thing. When writing JavaScript using a later version, you should always add at the top, use strict. This is kind of like the doc type, but for JavaScript. So this string, this statement, doesn't mean anything to old interpreters, but to new interpreters, this means we want to get rid of some of the quirks in the older language and use the newer, stricter language. So add this one. I'm actually not sure if we get an exception. No, it still works. So you can, having two functions with the same name, that doesn't do anything. Even if I had different number of parameters, the second one will overwrite the first one anyway. And I could do something like this, greet. Ellen and Johan. And when we run, Ellen greets you, or whatever I spelled that. So if you are calling the function with more arguments than parameters, those arguments are just tossed away. The first one will be matched against the name, and the rest will just be tossed away. Default parameters is a concept that you are familiar with in Java. Default parameters being, okay, if we don't send in a name, we want the default name to be John or Joe or something like that. And you do it like this in Java. Joe. Okay. Will it work? Will it work? Exciting to know. Yay, Joe greets you. This is an addition in the ES6. So this is quite a new addition. If you look at the default parameters on CanIUse, I guess you have full support in modern browsers. You don't have any support in like Internet Explorer, for instance. This won't work. But so this is an addition. Quite a neat one if you come from JavaScript. In Java you had to do it like in JavaScript before you had to do something like if name we could use actually this operator the OR operator. So if this one let's see if I get it right, name equals name or Joe, like that, right? So that was the old style way of doing this. So what it says is this: you can use the OR operator as a default operator, I think it's called, when you use it like this. So if name is false, then Joe will be returned. So instead of just evaluating this to true or false, the truthy part will be returned. So you can use this for kind of creating default parameters, but this is like hard to remember. So this is a welcome addition, I think, to just be able to do it like this. Yep.
Maybe I missed, but did you say why overloading methods does not work, or why didn't they?
They aren't in the language, and I don't see how you could add them when you don't have hard types, because it's loosely typed. You can't define that the name is a string and in the other function it should be a number, because it's just an untyped parameter.
Maybe only if you have different
different numbers, yeah. Or something, but it isn't like that. So no, overloading is not in the language. You can, if you like, you can do something like 1, 4, 5, 6. I have slides on this. I will go to the slides so I don't miss anything. Yeah, of course. Should you write code like this? Are you familiar with side effects and pure functions? No? In functional programming, side effects and pure functions is the thing. It's that you want to write functions that don't have side effects. That is, use stuff from outside the function or alters stuff outside the function. You want actually a function to be like you have the parameters x and y and you get a z as the result, and that's all the function does. So this is a side effect. Logging to the console is a side effect. If we should write this function without the side effect, we would instead do it like this. So we will return only the composed string, and then we will console log greet outside of this one instead. Whoa. One greets you, because we are adding one down here. This is a pure function, and a function without side effects. With a return statement. Every function in JavaScript will return, even if you don't write return. So a function doing nothing like that will return undefined. So it will return, and it will return undefined. We will get back to that because that's important. There is one way you can make this function not return undefined and return something else. Yep.
In previous slide.
No. Yeah, in the example.
Yeah. So Joe was overwritten by one.
Yep.
Because we
No, because why is so in this example, if I call greet with 1, 4, 5, 6, the 1 will be matched against the first parameter. The 2 will be matched against the second, the third against the third, and so on. So if I add 4 parameters, this 6, the argument 6, will be added to the last parameter. So it's just a simple match, actually. And the stuff not matched are tossed away. We have some new operators that will... Yep, here. No. Yeah, this is what I said about the default operators. So I have covered that. Yeah, hoisting. Remember, I can copy this. Takes some time to write it. So hoisting is a keyword or a word that is good to know when you're coding JavaScript. And hoisting is that if you declare a variable, hoisting will make it so that the declaration is moved to the top of the function. In this example, if I were to run this, you will see that the first console log will be undefined and the second will be 10. And yeah, makes sense. At this point, variable isn't defined, so it should be undefined, right? But if I comment this one away, we get a runtime error. We don't get undefined. Actually, we get an error saying that we can't find this variable isn't declared. So what happens with hoisting is that if we write the code like this, what actually happens is this. Whoa. So this is what the interpreter does. So all declarations of variables are moved to the top of the function. And that's good to know. A recommendation is actually to never declare variables in the middle of a function. That you always should declare the variable at the top and then assign them values when you need to use them. Just because that's what's happening under the hood. But yeah, there is no rule saying you can't assign and declare variables in the middle of a function. But considered somewhat a bad practice. I used var in this case to show the example. If we're using let instead, actually that I think it's like this. The variable is hoisted, the declaration is hoisted, but we will still get the reference error using let. So we can see it as it's not hoisted if you're using let. And hoisting is hissa på svenska. Making stuff go up, lifting. Yeah. Yeah. You might have seen that I wrote something strange in this function, right? I turned stuff around. I had it like this, and we all agreed that this was logical to have the function like this. You all knew what's going on, right? So we have a function, we call it like this. Nothing strange. Here comes the fun part, and the part that kind of changes everything. And that is that functions can be treated as values. A function is just like an object, or a number, or an array, or whatever. It's not some strange built-in stuff into the, yeah, it's kind of strange and built into the language, so that was not good to say. But you can think of functions that's something that you could just toss around in your code in the same way as you can do with variables. So to show that, we could just do it like this instead. instead. The scope equals function. Okay, what have I done? I've created a variable called the scope, and I'm assigning a function to that variable. Last year we used quotation marks. That's why I'm still into using quotation marks. Oh, good question. Do useStrict need to be double quotationed? I shouldn't be. I'm not sure. Maybe the interpreter just as looks at character by character. It's always like this with double quotes. Yes. I always write it with double quotes as well. I'll have to get back to that one. Yeah, I hope so. Yeah. I will definitely check that out. I got a question. I will answer your question on Slack there as well soon. But okay, does this look strange?
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's quite logical, right? I mean, why not? You can assign a string to a variable. You can assign an object to a variable. You can assign a function to a variable. Why not? This makes all the difference. And the difference is that you can pass functions around. You can pass a function to another function. You can return functions from other functions. Yeah, I will have some examples. It's quite hard to wrap your brain around it, but this is what makes functional programming special. That you can do stuff like this. So we just accept that we can do this. And it works. Hello. When we declare this is called a function declaration. Am I saying it right? No, this is called a function expression, and the other one is called a function declaration. I always get them mixed up, but the main part is that you know how to use them. So if I would try to do this, what do you think will happen? Any ideas? Crash. Because at the time of line 3, the scope has not been assigned to a function yet. If we were to use variable here instead, run it, it will still fail. But in this case, we know that the scope will be undefined, because var the scope will be written here. Var the scope. Oh my god, I'm terrible at finding the keys. Like that. This will also make it wrong. But this is kind of to illustrate what's happening, right? So the variable is declared. We are calling it as a function, but it's not a function yet. So we get an error, and then we are assigning it to a function. But if we were to change this into the scope and remove that one, then it will work. So functions declared using declaration is hoisted to the top of the function or file. In this case, because we don't have an outer function. But I will get back to the other one.
On the syntax. You have to write a parenthesis when you're using a function like a variable.
Do you mean when I call it?
Yeah, over there. So you cannot just
You can. So the question is, do you need the parentheses in this case? No, but it's not the same thing, because, and this is the point soon. So if we console log, and if you understand what I'm writing now, then you get a grip of this whole thing, I hope. Okay, if I ask, what will, and we return hello, sorry. What will happen when I run this code? It will print hello. Yeah, I would say so as well, because we are calling the function returns hello, and we are printing what it returns. Hello. What will happen if I do it like that? Still hello? Any other? No, someone is shaking their head. It will print function the scope. What this is a representation in the console that what we are trying to print is a function. We are actually trying to print or log the function. So this is a function reference. This is like a pointer to the function. But to call this one, we need the parentheses. But if we do it like this, let another function equals the scope. What will happen now? Error? Because? Because the another function is not a function yet. It's a variable. Actually, works. And that is because, remember, this is the reference to the function. This is just like a pointer to this function. So the scope is a reference to this. So when we are assigning let another function and assign the scope to another function, then we just copy the reference into another function. So now another function is referencing this, and the scope is referencing this. Is there a way to concatenate functions so they can execute after each other? I think you are, you're onto something, because that's called chaining. You can chain functions. So, okay, this wasn't planned, but let's see if you can wrap your mind around this. So instead of returning, okay, first of all, we must all agree upon that this is okay. So this function up here, the reference is stored in the scope, not the function itself. I mean, you can't store a whole function inside a variable, but you store a reference. It's a reference type. So you store the reference to the memory on the heap where the function is located. So this is something like a lot of numbers and letters, more or less. Okay, so that reference is copied. The reference is copied into another function. So now another function and the scope are both pointing at the same place in the memory where this function is located. So if I were to later on, that's not so easy to do with functions. Oh, no, forget it. Yeah. So let's do this that you were talking about, like concatenating functions or chaining functions. So instead of returning a string, we could actually return another function. And that function can return hello. Okay. So we have the scope that is a function that returns another function. So if we call the scope like this and try to run it, we get that, okay, this is a function. And now we can run that function but by just adding another set of parentheses. But you can do stuff like this. Oh, let's see if I can take it out of memory. Let's go to the slides. So I don't mess it up. But yes, you can. You can return functions, and you can have functions as parameters to other functions. So you can send functions to other functions. A function that is operating upon another function, returning it or having it as an argument, they are called higher order functions. So this outer function, the scope, is called a higher order functions. So a higher order functions is a part of the JavaScript language and any function-based language. I missed a question. I need to answer that one. If I can navigate to that screen, where are you? There. Can you use keyword arguments? Like in Python, where you can use def do something first. I can't see the rest. What? First, second, quergs. I haven't coded in Python. Actually, I think, John, if you are awake, you are more of a Python guy than I, so maybe you can answer that one. I'm not sure. Maybe it's like... Maybe I will answer that one, actually, because... Maybe right now. Okay, so this is the example I just ran, actually. When a function has no identifier, which this function, if we take the outer function, that function don't have an identifier until after the expression. Then it's identified by the scope. But this one, inside of this function, never gets an identifier. Not that we can see, anyway. So those are called anonymous functions. So this outer inner function is an anonymous function. It has no identifier. If you never call the scope, you can never access the inner one. You must have it returned and then store it in a variable. It's not anonymous anymore. And then you can operate on it. Or you can do it like this, that you operate on it right after it was created. You can actually do fun stuff like, if I dare to do it, I always mess up something. It's not a good thing to live code stuff on a lecture because it always gets wrong. You can do stuff like this. Name, console, log, name. No, I need some parentheses, I think. Those are the ones I always mess up. Ah, shite. What am I doing wrong?
It's calling. You need to take off that 9, the last one, console log,
this one. Maybe that one is the wrong one. Yeah, it was right all the way. Thanks. Let's see if I can remove them. I'm not sure I can. No. So. you can do stuff like this. Create an anonymous function and call it right as it is created. This is actually used for encapsulation in the browser. So in the browser, the running runtime environment is shared among all pages. And to encapsulate your own code from all other code, you can sometimes see constructions like this. We will instead look at modules, like you have modules in Java as well, and you import and export stuff, right? We will do the same thing in JavaScript. So we don't need this construction to encapsulate. But what happens under the hood is something like this. Yay! Whoa. So, writing functions like this, you will write a lot of functions in a functional language because you will toss functions around. And in the ECMAScript 6, they added something called arrow functions. I think you have those, like, you have it in C sharp anyway, and maybe in Java as well. So maybe you will be familiar with the syntax. I'm not sure what it's called in Java, but I will show you how it looks. So let's take this one as an example. Yeah, lambda expressions, I think. In Java 8, thank you. Okay, so we have this function that returns a function. So instead of writing all this syntax, we have a shorter version. And the shorter version is that this, I will break it out and write it here instead. This is the same thing as writing this. Okay. So what this is define an anonymous function with no parameters and return this expression. So we could do it like this, which is a more neater way to express returning this function. And if we like, do you see one more? If we want to write, if our goal is to write less code, why not I'm not sure you don't need no, I think we could do it like that. No, we couldn't. Oh, sorry. Parenthesis to the rescue. That one scared me. Let's see if we need those. No, don't need that one as well. Yeah, this is quite hard to grasp, but you could actually write that code like that. Let's back up one moment. If we had an argument to this function, we could do it like this, and then just add it to the string that is returned, and it will say undefined I am the anonymous, and we send in Johan, and we see that Johan, I am the anonymous. Okay. We don't need those parentheses when we only have one argument. Works still. If we, instead of returning, we want to have to write code, we could use curly brackets around this and do some stuff, and then manually return what we would like to do. So you could, those arrow functions, you could, like, you can write them in different ways depending on stuff. which I think can be hard to. I have still not learned how to just look at the code and actually but just know what's going on. Like with the for loop, if I see a for loop, I like, yeah, this is completely, I know everything. Great. But when I see arrow functions, I'm still like, oh wait, especially if they are nested, it's like, okay, so that one returns to that one. There is probably a smart way of reading the arrow functions so that your brain could actually know what's going on. I'm not there yet. I've not used arrow because the arrow functions is really new in the language. It came last fall, so I haven't had so much practice with them yet. But we will see examples later on that are really, really good with using arrow functions. Maybe I will use 10 minutes. I'm sorry, 10 more minutes. Nested scopes. Okay, you can define functions inside of functions. It's not that crazy of an idea when you've come to terms with functions as variables. I don't think this is so strange. But you can. So, why? Oh, other way around. We have a function outer scope that has a parameters that defaults to one. We have some result defined. We have a new function inside that's called first inner scope and a second function called second inner scope. The first one just returns 10 and the second one just returns 20. And we have some if statement that says, okay, if run function, this one is one, then run the first inner scope, then otherwise the second inner scope, and we returns the result. And then we r calls out the scope and it returns 20. So this is not so strange. Just the thing to notice is that we can define functions inside of other functions. And we can do this how deep we like. We can inside the first inner scope, we can define a new function and a new function, and we can have in scope nested like that. However, what is good to know is that inner functions can always access outer functions variables. So an inner function has access to the outer functions universe. Remember this result up here? So we set the result to zero, and inside functions, we can alter the outer functions variables. So when the first inner scope is called, the result is adding 10, and when the second scope is called, the result is added 20, even though result isn't declared inside this function. And what happens is that when the interpreter comes to this line 10, it will see, okay, result. Is result defined inside of this function? No, it's not. Then it will go to the next scope and look, is the result defined here? Yeah, it is. And then it will use that one. If it wasn't found here, it will go to the next scope, and the next scope in this case is the global scope, where everything is in the language. We shouldn't put stuff there. I have done this outer result is actually on the global scope because we have no function encapsulating that one. And this leads up to something called closures. You say that a function closes over another function, and inner function closes over the outer function. And if we go back to this example I was trying to write before, but good thing I didn't. Can I give some practical examples when nesting function chaining is useful? Yeah, there will be. this is an example, maybe an academic one, but it's an example. We have a multiplier that we could add a factor to. So we have our multiplier. We want to be able to multiply different stuff. We want to square them or multiply them three times. So we create a multiplier function returning a new function that uses the factor of the multiplier and the number to the inner function. And we call the multiplier with 2 back. We will get this anonymous function. We will call it twice. So this twice function, I mean, twice is only a reference to that code. But still, if we call twice, when the function twice is run, it still has access to the outer function scope. And this is what's called closure. So even though this function multiplier has returned, and in Java it would probably be long gone because it has returned, there are no reference to it maybe, so maybe it's all already destroyed even. But the inner function will still have access to the outer function's scope. So the scope will be there like glued to this function in the memory, more or less. So when we call this one, number is 5 and the factor is 2 and we get the result 10. And this is called closure. This concept is quite hard to wrap your mind around in the beginning. I would argue if you understand this example, how it kind of works, then you more or less cracked the code to JavaScript. Because there are so many things going on here that you are not used to in Java. You have regular expressions. I asked last time if you have used them. You do it like the same way in JavaScript. You just use this. It's the same in Java, right? You use this slash. I think so. You have regular expressions. There is a saying, have you heard it? If you're trying to solve a problem using regular expressions, you have 2 problems. Not sure it's true, but you can mess up stuff with regular expressions. Error handling, you have try, catch, finally, and you can throw errors. Same stuff as in Java. Won't dwell upon that. So, before lunch, this lecture compressed into just some statements. Okay, we just assign numbers by the literal number literal. We just write a number strings with a string literal, booleans true or false. We add functions with the arrow function. Literal, so to speak, or writing out function if we like. That's nothing wrong with that. Regular expressions, you have the slash arrays after the break, brackets. We've already looked at those, and curly brackets for creating objects. You are used to creating objects out of classes, and we don't have classes. We don't have classes in JavaScript. I will explain that after the break. So, okay, we will start again in like 1 hour. There will be a lot of stuff going into your brain this afternoon. It's a good thing everything is recorded. I will link numerous talks around the topics I think it's interesting. And I will recommend some of those as well. Okay, thanks.